Hey guys, coming at you from the frozen tundra that is East Central Alberta, Canada. Streaming live on YouTube, Facebook, Float, Odyssey, Telegram, Twitch, and the Prepper Broadcast Network. Welcome back to the workshop where we create community, find freedom, promote preparedness, and share success. I am Toolman Tim, and this is the point where I would normally tell you what the date is, what this episode number is, but this will be one of six episodes that I am pre-recording because at the moment I am somewhere south of the Canadian-US border, either at Prepper Camp in North Carolina, at Tactical Response in Camden, Tennessee, or Self-Reliance Festival at SOE in Camden as well. So, no announcements, no numbering. What you will find is these are going to be much shorter episodes. This one is going to be very different. We'll talk about that in a minute. But there's not going to be any numbering till after the fact, because I'm sure I will do some live streams from the road. I want to share my thoughts with you as I'm going, but I wanted to make sure you guys had some content while I was away. So here we are. Okay, so I don't know where to start with this episode. This is going to be something totally different than I normally do. Conspiracies. Well, not really. Okay, you guys remember the 90s? I used to have a friend that said, if you remembered the 60s, you weren't really there. But that's a whole other story for another day. I was a big X-Files fan back in the day. For whatever reason, things like paranormal, aliens, Area 51, conspiracies, when I was in high school, just got me going. Loved them. I don't know why. Some of the odd kind of weird ones that just stuck in my brain. And if you guys remember the early 90s, the advent of the internet, I want to say the first time I used the internet was grade 10, so that would have been 95 probably, back in web crawler days, even before Ask Jeeves. Oh, and Netscape. Oh, remember Netscape Communicator? That's a whole nother. Oh, GeoCities, remember that. Anyway, so I used to spend a lot of time on the internet or taking out UFO books from the library. Always fun. How much I believed in them, I don't know. But they always intrigued me, interested me. So tonight we're going to talk about something along those lines. Two, I don't know. I will be very surprised if any one of you guys have heard of both of these incidents. I'll bet you've probably heard of one or the other. Maybe you've heard of both. I don't know. But they're really interesting. So the first one, I wish I had grown up listening to Art Bell on Coast to Coast. For whatever reason, he came into my field of view in the last couple of years. Didn't know him, of course, didn't know of him while he was alive, while he was doing Coast to Coast and then later on Midnight in the Desert. But I have a really deep respect for the man. I've actually, my opening, whether you noticed it or realize it or not, is actually modeled after his opening for Coast to Coast. And he always gave people, no matter how crazy or cockamine, whatever their ideas might have seemed, he always gave them their say. He would always sit and listen to them talk. And he had some interesting things. And some of it may have been, you know, theater of the radio, something similar to War of the Worlds. I don't know. Who knows? But what I can tell you is this one that I ran into recently, and maybe you know this one, but we're going to deal with two semi-famous signal intrusions from the past. Whatever the story behind them is, they're intriguing. This one maybe has been solved depending on who you talk to. The second one we're going to talk about tonight definitely hasn't. We're going to try something new. I'm going to play the audio. I don't think it's going to get any copyright flags because it's on YouTube as it is. The video is going to be very small, but I want you to listen to some of it. So we're going to do the Art Bell one first. I'll commentate a little bit as we go along, but basically fill you in. This was September 11th, 1997. So that was back before, obviously, September 11th had the meaning that it has today. But he used to do a call-in show that if you worked at Area 51, this was the phone number you could call as a whistleblower type thing. Rather interesting. I always thought it was kind of cool. I've gone back and listened to a bunch of his old shows, and this was one that every time you search Art Bell and Coast to Coast, this comes up. So this guy comes on and he's really breathy, out of breath. Sounds like he's been chased for a while. I don't want to spoil it all. Let's start it. Let's bring up the screen here. Hang on one second. We'll bring this up. I hope you can hear it. We will play it and we'll see what happens.
I don't have a lot of time.
Well, look, let's begin by finding out whether you're using this line properly or not.
Eric said you are.
The guy sounds legitimately scared.
Former employee. I was let go on a medical discharge about a week ago, and I've kind of been running across the country. I don't know where to start. They're gonna triangulate on this position really, really soon.
You can't spend a lot of time in the phone.
So, it could be theater. The guy could be a good actor, but he sounds scared shitless.
What we're thinking of as aliens are they're extra dimensional beings that an earlier precursor of the space program made contact with. They are not what they claim to be. They've infiltrated a lot of aspects of the military establishment.
So the guy keeps going like this for a while. I'll skip ahead a bit.
The few that are left will be more easily controllable. I started getting...
So there he is, mid-sentence. Go silent. That's all you hear. That's it. Goes off the air, just like that. I don't know. If I was a conspiracy theorist, I'd think one of those alphabet agencies turned the signal off on them. Art Bell went on to say years down the road that they had never had a signal intrusion like that before where their signal was actually cut off. So then here comes their music, and this was his iconic Coast to Coast radio theme song. I'll talk over it just a little bit, just in case it gets caught for copyright. Let's skip ahead just a bit here.
Some way, something knocked us off the air, and we're on a backup system now.
Is it government or?
I don't know.
It has to be something, though.
Well, did you hear? Now, you tell me because you were listening.
That was awful strange.
There was a really weird guy on the air when it went off?
Yeah. Real weird.
This is a new caller here.
Sort of sounding paranoid.
Yeah. Like crying and everything.
Yeah.
So there's totally the possibility that this was a put on, a scam. I don't know. But like he said, it's never happened before. There was something so homey about AM radio. I loved it.
It was really strange. All of a sudden, I'm hearing Mark Furman.
Well, the network throughout what blew up here. So that's what you heard happen. And then we're now on a backup link system to be on the air at all right now. So, well, I'm telling you.
Am I on the air right now?
You're on.
Yeah, I called the other night. And
Okay, so I don't know. What do you guys think of that? Kind of interesting, kind of entertaining. I like this stuff. I hope you enjoy this. It's just something weird and completely different. I went off the rails with my movie shows. You guys love those. We've got the book club. You guys seem to love those. This thing, it's like, I don't know. First off, I have a soft spot for AM radio, talk radio in general. I grew up in Nova Scotia. Almost all the radio stations we could get was either the local AM or some stations from New Brunswick. CFBC was an AM station and eventually moved over to FM. They had Talk of the Town on there. And for years, they had a guy, Tom Young. And one thing that's really funny is if you only listen to somebody in audio for years and finally see their picture, they never look like you think they're going to look. But I always loved listening to AM radio. There was just something special about it. And I don't know, it just brings me back to a simpler time. But this was kind of fun. This one was from 1997. You can read out there. Some people say it's legit. Most people say this was a hoax. It was a put on. It was a publicity stunt, whatever you want to say. But it was a pretty damn good one. He's got another one if you want to go down another rabbit hole, pardon the pun, called Mel's Hole. I think that might have been out of their Ghost to Ghost episode where they did Halloween stories, but it was supposedly a recording from the deepest hole ever drilled in Russia. and it was supposed to be demon screaming. It was definitely a fake. I think he even admitted to that. But this one was kind of cool. So if you've never heard of this one, you want to go down a bit of a rabbit hole. It was September 11th, 1997. Art Bell with the Area 51. Just type in Art Bell Area 51 caller and you can find all kinds of videos on the internet. So that one's cool. I enjoy that one. But this one is my favorite. Now, I'm an old-timey Reddit user. I've been on it for well over a decade. I don't use it a whole lot anymore. But I used to use Reddit to go down the old rabbit hole and check out some really interesting conspiracy theory, just everything. It was just fun. I love it. It's entertaining to me. Like I said, I remember one time my heart was broken because I asked Dad if he could set the VCR to record X-Files for me because I had forgotten. And he said, sure. And I came home and he forgot. And I always remember good old VHS recordings of the X-Files. But I lived for it. Started out, I believe it was on Friday nights, and then it went over to Sundays. And I just loved the show. And this kind of stuff was right up my alley. So this is something I came across, I don't know, 10 or 15 years ago. So first off, I'm going to ask you, have you ever heard of Max Headroom? Yes, I said Max Headroom. Yeah, that's where the name came from. So for anybody who is less than 40 years old, there's a good chance you're like, what the hell are you talking about, Tim? And if it is, totally fine. But he was a character, a so-called CGI character from the mid-1980s. He wasn't. He was actually a Canadian actor in makeup made to look like a computer-generated image. And they would he practiced the stuttering speech. And they would slow down and speed up the cadence of his voice to make him sound interesting and techie. So anyway, he ended up being, he had a, I want to say it was either VH1 or MTV music. He had like this TV show where he reviewed music videos, that kind of thing, which was cool. Also, if you're under 40, you might not know what music videos are, but we used to sit around and wait for our favorite song to come on the TV. I know it's weird, but that's for another day. He also did the new Coke when Coke came out. He was a spokesman for that. That's what I always remember him for, except I used to get him confused with Robert Palmer. Robert Palmer used to do a Pepsi commercial. And if you remember that, anyway, I don't know, stupid things we did as kids. But he was an interesting dude. For a very short period of time, Max Headroom was in the zeitgeist of popular culture. He existed. He was around. Everywhere you went, you could see him. He was so popular that you used to be able to buy rubber masks of his face. Which leads me into my favorite signal intrusion of all time. This one is kind of cool. It is just referred to as the Max Headroom incident. It's on the surface, it seems boring. To me, it's intriguing because this one actually happened. It actually happened on a national broadcast network or close to a national broadcast network. It's completely 100% unsolved to this day. No matter how far you go down the internet rabbit hole, all of the different conjecture and hearsay, nobody has ever admitted to it because at the time they would have seen some serious jail time. So let me set this up for you. People in the Chicago area were sitting down that evening, getting ready to watch Doctor Who. Who? Doctor Who. Yes. It was on, and all of a sudden, there was actually two of these signal intrusions. This weirdo all of a sudden shows up on the screen, looks like Max Headroom, wearing a Max Headroom mask. You can barely understand what he's saying. There's a piece of corrugated steel behind him, waving back and forth to kind of, looks like some kind of 1960s fever dream, you know, something that the 1960s would think the far-flung future of 1995 would look. But this happened in 1987. So the first intrusion was on WGN. So if you guys have heard of WGN, that's a big network. And it only lasted for about 28 seconds because what happened was when they interfered with the signal, eventually WGN either turned over to new transmitters or turned their power up, whatever it happened to be. And they were able to knock it out. So these, you know, modern day hackers, you know, 1980s, there's something about that. They went to a smaller station, WTTW. Now, the reading I've done on this is it would have required quite a bit of expertise. So the prevailing theory goes that it was an ex-employee who was pissed off at the networks or something, got fired. They don't know. There are some theories of who did it. The people have never said it. But you would need to be within line of sight of the building, the transmission tower, and you would need to have a really high powered transmitter in a van or a truck. So if anybody has any more information about this, let me know. But I'm going to play the video for you. It's only 2 minutes long. For those of you in the audio, it can be hard. I will turn it up. You can listen to it. I won't commentate much on this. I'm sure this is in the public domain. Nobody's ever claimed it, but it's just hard to hear. So I'll shut the hell up. Let me play it, and then we'll talk about it a little bit more. So Doctor Who is on there right now. It's hard to see. Let's bring up the screen. We'll share that, and we will play. You should go back with the old ones if you'll try. It's the only way to learn. I'll get you a walkthrough. There was a reference to Coke there, catch the wave, and he threw the can down. Before that, it was Chuck Swirsky, who was a TV sports personality. You could understand that. And then he said, freaking nerds. Now he's singing. So this went on, goes on for about 90 seconds on live TV. A bunch of people, family sitting around watching Doctor Who. Something about newspaper nerds, you can barely make him out at this point. I don't have a clue what happened. Now he's got a big glove on. I don't know. Honestly, seems like some kind of teenager or college student. Then there's a lady slapping him with a fly swatter here for just a second. And then it goes black. You hear the audio. And back to Doctor Who. Is that not weird? So if you're not interested in this, I apologize. It's only like a 20-25 minute episode, but I think it's pretty cool. I don't know why. I always wanted to share it. I've read up on it for years. I just to think about the work that would have to go into some sort of signal intrusion like that. It reminds me when in the early 90s, I got a hold of these 1-800 numbers that you could call into and check your voicemail on. And they all had the exact same password for the voicemail box, a generic password. So me and some buddies on the internet got a hold of them. We went in, we would change the passwords, and then we would turn them into our own toll-free information line. And you could leave whatever you wanted on there. You could call in and get your information. It was our own little hacking, you know, kind of like the Anarchist Cookbook, all that stuff from back in the day. This, I don't know. It took some work. Somebody was pissed off at somebody to do this and to try it twice. And the second one is the one that everybody remembers because the second one had audio. Apparently the first one, 28 seconds or whatever on WGN, didn't have any audio, just video. But it would creep you out. You imagine just sitting at home, you know, having your TV dinner, you get your TV trays out and, you know, hubby comes home from work. You've been waiting all week for the new episode of Doctor Who. Sit down and damn it, it gets interrupted by some Yahoo in a rubber mask with a floating sheet of corrugated steel behind it. And all because either somebody's pissed off at their former employer or some college students who are like, you know what? I just want to try it and see if I can do it. And that's where a lot of this hacking ended up. Just rather interesting. Is there any lessons in this? Well, it's entertaining. Let's put it that way first. It shows me that no matter how hardened or well-built a communication system is, it can always be hacked or dealt with, even in today's, you know, day and age. Like nowadays, you know, you can have a Russian hacker from all the way across the world, you know, slide in and steal your bank passwords. But back then, this kind of stuff had to be done with hardware. It had to be done line of sight. You had to show up. You had to put, you know, you had to have a stake in the game. You knew if you got caught, you were going to jail. Nowadays, they don't even know who is hacking you. And if you tried to call the cops, they'd laugh at you and say, well, good luck getting your money back. you're the dummy for trying to, you know, get your inheritance from an African prince. So anyway, I think this is interesting. I hope you enjoyed it. To me, it's fun. This is one of those episodes would be kind of cool to see on video for those of you who are listening to audio. But for the most part, you should be able to hear it. I apologize for the audio quality, especially on the second one. But these are old. I mean, this is 34-year-old audio that was recorded over-the-air television and onto a VCR tape, VHS tape, and then uploaded to YouTube some 20-some years later. So there it lies. So I hope you enjoyed this. If you guys have other interesting things like this that you'd like to see me do a follow-up on, give me a holler. Send me an email at therealtimcook@gmail.com or just comment if you're in Fountain. Leave a Boostergram and say, hey, here's one. Check this out. I'll do a follow-up. Free, great, I will. Maybe we'll do one for Halloween. Although I got a couple of ideas. I think we're probably going to do 2 Halloween episodes this year, I think. We'll see how it goes. But anyway, guys, as always, stay happy, stay healthy, and have a great week.